Now it's time for Toker Talk Radio, the voice of the marijuana nation.
What are you people? On dope?
Where you can toke.
I inhale frequently.
Or you can talk.
I experimented with marijuana and didn't inhale.
Or you can toke and talk.
10 federal criminal penalties for possession of up to 1 ounce of marijuana.
While we talk about toke on Toker Talk Radio.
So by the way, when it comes to pot, you know, if you're 40 years old, you live in a log cabin in Oregon, you got 12 giant pot plants in your backyard, have a ball.
Live from beautiful Portland, Oregon at Rolla J Studios.
Cannabis.
Plus your calls live at 971-533-7111.
They're walking on their pants with their cap on backwards, listening to the Enema Man and Snoopy Snoopy Poop Dog.
What's to keep somebody from getting all potted up on weed and then getting behind the wheel?
Gateway theory doesn't work. It's a reality.
Holland, is it real? Don't tease me.
We're locking up people that take a couple of puffs of marijuana, and the next thing you know, they got 10 years.
And now, here's your host, the guru of ganja graphics, the sultan of sativa statistics, and the worst nightmare of a reefer mad prohibitionist. A polite, perspicacious, productive pothead with a propensity for PowerPoint. Radical Russ Belleville.
Here we go, a little dig dug to get the day started. Welcome, it's Toker Talk Radio, I'm Radical Russ. That's Brian the Red. You know what I always thought was funny about dig dug? Here's a game where you're digging holes and tunnels, approaching monsters, and blowing them up with a bicycle pump till they explode.
Well, you know, along the same kind of what the fuck kind of mentality, there is another game called Rainbow Island, and that one you went around with a vacuum cleaner sucking up monsters, and then you would spit them back out of the vacuum at other monsters. Love that game.
I tell you, how did they ever come up with these games without copious amounts of weed?
Or LSD.
One or the other, man. That's like, pretty crazy stuff. But welcome to Toker Talk Radio. We're talking a little bit right now about the whole Washington medical marijuana mess, and as I go off on that rant, and I've been going off on it all weekend long, getting a lot of flack from a lot of people. I definitely touched a nerve. I wanted to make sure I added a few other things, right? The main gist of the rant is, we're only going to get six plants. We're only going to get pot stores where we can have three times the limits of recreational users. Do you realize? Let me tell you what
we're going to need to be put on a list where we'll be protected if we're found on that list. That's the one that I find the most ridiculous.
I know. Yeah,
because we've had a registry here in Oregon since it was started back in 98 or 99, you know, and it's only protected patients.
Yeah. And now,
except for the ones who were breaking the law.
That's right.
I want to break the law.
Don't legalize. You'll ruin our loopholes. You'll ruin our loopholes.
That's all we're hearing. You guys don't want to follow, you know, the current laws that have been voted in. You want to keep doing things the way that you've been doing them. You don't want to come into compliance for the short term while we fix the laws that we have passed so that you will no longer be criminals ever again.
Yeah.
No, you'd rather stay criminals. Yeah.
Now, to be fair, and I want to try to be fair about this. If you're going to make a roadmap of how to legalize marijuana and you want the positive example and you want the negative example, you've got Colorado and Washington. I am not sitting here trying to endorse what's going on in Washington State.
No.
I'm trying to explain why you shouldn't be surprised it's happening. That's why what I'm trying to say here.
Yeah.
Like we said, 14 years of medical marijuana to get its shit together, to show the public that you were willing to regulate dispensaries, that you're willing to put some brakes on this, that you're willing to have some controls on this. But there's so many true believers out there, you know, it should be treated like tomatoes. It should be free for everyone at all times, for any purpose whatsoever, at all places.
And it should. And one day it may be. But this is not that day. And until we follow the guidelines that are voted in by the majority, until we can change them, until we change their minds and they see, oh, well, I guess it's not you know, the end of the world. Okay, well, let's have them, let them have a little bit more leeway. Yeah. Oh, well, it looks like the sky's not falling yet. Well, you know, let's, and eventually we'll have it. So, oh, hey, man, you want some G13? Nah, man, I got fucking tons of G13. You got any train wreck? nah, man, only a little bit.
That's exactly it. It's this lack of willingness to understand and compromise for political reality. And I get so many, I was going rounds on Twitter the other night with somebody who goes by the Ganja Queen. Right. And I was trying to, you know, I was trying to criticize people who have this. I actually started with someone critiquing my pro pot myths that must be debunked article, you know, and part of this is what I'm trying to get marijuana reformers to do is to grow up a little, to mature a little. When you come at the mainstream, when you come at reasonable folks who know nothing about marijuana and you say things like hemp will save the planet, they don't believe you. Now, will hemp help the planet? Absolutely. Oh my God, there's so many things hemp will do to help the planet. But the planet's got bigger problems than can be solved with hemp alone. Yeah. For instance, people talk about, oh, we'll legalize hemp and we'll make biodiesel. Okay, great. I'm all for biodiesel. It'll go right into every diesel engine right now. It'll go right into every truck right now. Be a great idea if Walmart could put, Walmart alone converted its trucks to biodiesel. That would be a huge impact on our environment, a positive impact. But here's the thing. Not everybody is going to convert to biodiesel. There's still millions and millions and millions of gas cars out there. Uh-huh. Now, they say, well, you know, you can get a $500 conversion kit. Really? You got $500? Is the government going to give $500 out to the poor people who can't afford the gas conversion kits?
No, not when they've got $2 billion bombers to build by the dozens.
Are we going to convert all the cars? And the motorcycles, and the ATVs, and the Jeeps, and the jet skis, and the leaf blowers, and the, I mean...
And the mopeds.
And the mopeds, and
every,
so forth.
Everything that requires the current, you know, gas technology. But, no, it won't convert it overnight. And we just got to realize that this is an ongoing process. It's been ongoing for the last 80 years of Prohibition. And it's still going to keep going until we finally get where we want to go. But we're not going to get there if we keep quibbling over tiny minutiae.
Right on, man. We got to take a break. And when we come back, we'll talk more about that and the Washington State mess. We'll also take your calls at 971-533-7111. Listen to Toker Talk Radio on 420radio.org. We'll be right back. Stick around.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
Cast your eyes up to the skies. What is it to live and die?
When you are starting up a medical cannabis business, you don't just want any attorney. You want a fired-up lawyer who understands the needs of cannabis consumers. The Law Office of Lauren Vasquez is your fired-up lawyer for the cannabis industry. Lauren Vasquez knows the details of California marijuana law from both a personal and professional angle. Lauren Vasquez rose from the ranks of college normal activist to become one of the Bay Area's best marijuana lawyers. Visit her website, fireduplawyer.com, or call 1-855-MMJ-LAWS for more information. That's 855-665-5297 for Lauren Vasquez, your Fired Up Lawyer, or email fireduplawyer@gmail.com. The number again is 855-MMJ-LAWS, 855-665-5297 for your Fired Up Lawyer, Lauren Vasquez. Lauren Vasquez is an activist attorney you can trust. Call today. 420 Radio, the home of marijuana experts.
Hey, Tokers and Tokettes, Radical Russ here to introduce you to my friend Matt and all the staff at Lush LED Lighting. Growing plants indoors can be a rewarding hobby, but electricity bills can go through the roof. Then you have to cool down all those big hot lights. It can drive a grower insane. With Lush LED Lighting, you can solve many of these issues and double your rewards. If you thought LEDs were... meet the tech of today. Matt and his scientists have developed the perfect light for flowering plants with far less cost and heat. And the results?
Let's just say I appear at a lot of events with the masters of indoor horticulture, and the harvests I saw from Lush LED lighting were big, tight, sticky, and very effective. Check out LushLEDLighting.com right now and tell them Radical Russ sent you. Double your rewards and lower your expenses with Lush LED Lighting.
Welcome back, everybody. That's Mystic Revealers with Warplanes playing in the background, and you're listening to Toker Talk Radio. I'm Radical Russ. This is Brian the Red hanging out. We're just talking about the state of things up here in the Pacific Northwest, and I wanted to just give you a rundown. Before I do, though, before I get back into that stuff, let's do something funny. Let's do something funny, ha-ha. Okay. Ha-ha. I got to show you this. Okay, so you probably have these.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
These magazines throughout your area, whatever, wherever you're at, right? Busted is the name of the magazine. And the point of it is they take the mugshots of people that were busted, right? They're public knowledge.
And they're great because it's like a weekly.
Right.
You know, and so they take everybody who's been busted in the last week because their mugshots are all public and the charges are public because they've been arrested. And then they list them up there, you know, like, so it's like possession, methamphetamines, domestic disturbance, you know.
But you can get these at a lot of like convenience stores. Mm-hmm. Let's use like a buck, and the money maker for them is they'll put you in this kind of thing. They put you online, and then if you want to get it taken down, they'll charge you money, right?
Yeah.
Well, the point I wanted to get to, though, I saw this today at the convenience store. Busted, America's $1, you know, top crime paper, right?
I've got a few people, friends, who are in this.
Check this out.
I thought this was good.
Colorado 420 holiday giveaway. Win an all expense paid trip to Colorado for two for the weekend of 420-2014.
Does not include tickets to the Denver High Times Cannabis Cup.
But I'm just thinking, you know, talk about know your audience, man. Jesus. It's kind of insulting though, right? It's like what? You think only people that get busted, you know, that we're all just criminals, that we're the only ones who'd want, I mean, I don't know. It's just, I saw this today and it just cracked me up. So I had to say something about it. The Busted Magazine win the Colorado 420 giveaway. All right. So back to the subject at hand here, which is Washington State and what's going on there. Let me give you a look at what has gotten through the Senate. This is just passed the Senate there. I think it's passed in this same form, but I could be wrong. But it passed out of the Senate, and it's the bill to try to reconcile what's going on, you know, having a legal recreational program and having a legal medical program, right? And originally, when this was first proposed, it was proposed with all sorts of draconian cuts. You were going to go from 24 ounces to 3 ounces. You're going to go from 15 plants to 3 plants. You're going to have no tax breaks, just a sales tax break. You're going to have the same number of pot shops. All the dispensaries that currently exist are going to close down. You're going to have no collective gardens. I mean, when this first came out, it looked pretty bad. Looked pretty bad. Here's what it got amended to. Check this out. And as I read this to you, I want you to consider, if you're a medical user out there, just how awful this would be. What a terrible program this would be if you had to introduce this in your state. First of all, they added concentrates to the definitions and limits. They added concentrates. Now, in a lot of medical marijuana states, and I didn't check, but I know it's the majority. In the majority of medical marijuana states, concentrates are illegal. They are felonies still. California, concentrate, felony.
Yeah, even if you've just got like a keef box and, you know, it's got a tray to catch the sift, well, that's a concentrate.
Could be. Well, that's a Oklahoma thing, I think. Well, but at least for the BHOs, for sure.
A couple places.
Now, in this definition of concentrates, a recreational user can possess 7 grams. You can possess a 1/4 ounce of dab.
Wow.
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 That's a lot. That's a lot of dab, folks. I just bought a 1/2 gram of some of Ganja John's concentrate.
I do dab.
Last week, and I've been sharing it with people, and yep, I still have some.
He still has dab.
I still have some. So 7 grams? Holy crap, that'd last a long time.
You gotta stop saying dab. It's dabs.
And that is in addition to the 1 ounce of bud, the 16 ounces, 1 pound of edibles, and 72 ounces, or a 6-pack of tincture. Now that's for recreational users, right? So now with this new bill, recreational users can have concentrates legally.
Yeah. Well, and it's tinctures or infused oils for cooking and such.
Right? No, the infused oils are still the 72 ounce liquids.
Oh.
Yeah. You can have 72 ounces of oil.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can have a 6-pack of infused oil.
Well, no, that's what I was saying. Yeah. Same as tinctures.
Right. Okay. Yes. Gotcha. Another thing they're going to add, you know how they came up with a limit of how many stores there are going to be? There's only going to be 334 stores statewide, 21 in Seattle. Now they're going to add an endorsement that a store can get to be a medical provider. So stores can get this new medical endorsement. With the new medical endorsement, they'd be able to serve patients 18 and older, not just 21 and older, the recreational side is, right? 18 and older.
That's a big leeway.
And they're going to make the Liquor Control Board, which is going to be renamed the Liquor and Cannabis Board. They're going to make the Liquor Board reevaluate how many shops there should be to take into account these new medical things, right? These new medical licenses, right?
Excellent.
So they're basically saying, all right, we've evaluated that you need about 21 recreational shops in Seattle. Mm-hmm. But we're going to go back and take a look at how many medical users there are in Seattle and then add more stores that can have those medical licenses.
Yeah, X amount per Y.
Now, it won't be the 200 some odd dispensaries that exist in Seattle now.
Oh, hell no.
But those are illegal.
Yes, you didn't write that into your law. You didn't fight for that.
Now, here's the medical change. They are going to reduce the 24 ounces of bud to 3 ounces of bud. However, your doctor can recommend more. So if you really are that seriously sick person using Rick Simpson oil for your stage 4 cancer and you need an ounce a day, your doctor can recommend that.
Yeah. But unfortunately, if you are, as Russ termed earlier, a loophole surfer, then you might not be able to increase your amount. And then you'd be back on the recreational side, which...
They'd still be patients, and they would get 3 times the limit recreational.
That's right.
They're redefining. They're saying the 24 ounces will be down to 3 ounces, but your doctor can recommend more. Mm-hmm. They're going to increase the edible limit for patients to 3 pounds. They're going to increase the liquid limit to an 18-pack of liquid. And they're going to allow 21 grams of concentrate for patients.
That's almost an entire ounce.
Three quarters of an ounce of Earl.
That is a lot of dab.
Being legalized.
Yeah, I mean, for someone who's just a consumer, you know, even medically, like even if you took, 5 my-size dabs an hour, that would still last you weeks.
Now, they are going to redefine the cultivation limits. They're going down from 15 plants to 3 mature, 3 immature, just like Colorado, by the way. 3 plants mature, 3 plants immature, but your doctor can still recommend up to the 15 plants you're currently growing. So again, if you are the seriously sick stage 4 cancer patient needs an ounce a day, your doctor can recommend 15 plants, and the patient can possess all the bud his plants produce up to 8 ounces. So yeah, it's not 24. It's up to 8.
But
what else? Oh, no sales taxes. They're going to get out of the 25% retail tax and the local sales tax, but they'd still be stuck with the 25% grower, 25% processor, because that's already going to be built into the price. Well, still, I bet they end up with cheaper weed than what you could get in most any other state. Mm. Now, these dispensaries that are operating under the collective gardens loophole, 10 patients with a collective garden, they don't even have to close down until July of 2015. And during that time, they can work to get their legitimate medical endorsement. But they're not getting rid of collective gardening, like some of these people say. They're actually redefining collective gardening to allow 4 patients, but you have to really garden, not just hand money over. You have to really be a part of the garden. And you can cultivate up to your maximum limit of plants for 4 patients. Now, the minimum would be 12 plants because they can each have 3 mature, right? The max could be 60 if they all had recommendations up to 15 each. And 60 is bigger than the 45 collectives are allowed now.
Yeah.
And they could possess their max limit of usable cannabis. If each of them can get up to 8 ounces, that's 32 ounces. That's 2 pounds. There's going to be a mandatory registry so that patients will be protected from arrest finally in that state. They don't have any arrest protection right now. They're going to tighten the definition of intractable pain so that they can stop, you know, people, you know, faking a backache and getting a card. They're going to tighten the definition of the doctor-patient relationship, allegedly, I would think, to get rid of the specialty clinics. And they're going to make it a class 3 civil infraction, a ticket, if you use marijuana in public. So that's the gutting of Washington State medical marijuana.
Well,
that's the devastating change that's going to leave patients dying in the streets.
Sounds like some compromises to me.
We got to take a break. Come back, talk some more.
Oh, have you ever met that funny reefer man? A reefer man. Have you ever met that funny reefer man? A reefer man. If he said he swam to China, he would sell you South Carolina. Then you know you're talking to that reefer man.
I'm Radical Russ Belville, and I want to thank you for listening to 420 Radio. We couldn't survive without you and our sponsors, and I'd like you to check out one of our prime sponsors, the National Cannabis Coalition. I've been working with NCC since June of 2012, and I'm proud to be part of the team they have assembled. National Cannabis Coalition is building the partnerships with reformers, lawmakers, and industry we need to be successful. Visit the National Cannabis Coalition website at nationalcannabiscoalition.com or the easier-to-remember ncc420.com. That's where you'll get the exclusive first look at my radical rants, as well as informative articles from the nation's top cannabis pundits. Visit ncc420.com today, and if you have your phone handy, text Russ to 420-420 to support NCC and 420 Radio. It's a free text message that helps us help you end adult marijuana prohibition. Learn more at ncc420.com, and thanks for supporting independent marijuana legalization public radio.
Mary, marijuana, do you wanna? Mary, do you wanna tonight?
As marijuana goes mainstream, you need to be armed with the facts. Nobody can teach you better than Dr. Mitch Earlywine, PhD. You may know Dr. Mitch from his column in High Times magazine or his weekly appearance on the Russ Belville Show. Dr. Mitch is also the author of some of the best books on marijuana science, culture, history, and health, including Understanding Marijuana, Parents' Guide to Marijuana, Pot Politics, and more. Visit Amazon.com and search for Mitch Earlywine, that's Earlywine, and order your books today. You can also contact Dr. Mitch by email at 420research@gmail.com. Did you miss your favorite 420radio.org show during its regular airtime? Don't worry, you can catch the replay this weekend on 420radio.org. Visit our schedule page for more information.
All in, all or not, pedal to the metal. Yeah. Only the strong survive, nope, don't settle. No. Give it 110 and bubble the tea kettle. Ready to rumble and never to fumble. I'm going, let me tell you how I'm going to go.
Welcome back, everybody. Toker Talk Radio, 23 after the hour. That's music from the Dirt Ball out of Bend, Oregon. My favorite rapper.
Liebermaier loves the Dirt Ball, too.
I know. Thank you, Liebermaier. Maybe because I have 5 or 6 of his albums in the list.
Well, that would make sense.
All right. So we were talking about Washington State's new medical marijuana bill that's been passed by the Senate. It's headed to the governor's desk. It'll probably be signed. And it finally gets around to defining some of the medical marijuana limits here. And a lot of the medical marijuana people in Washington State are upset because their 60-day supply is now being redefined. Their 60-day supply was defined as originally was, well, nobody knew. Right? When the law first passed, the 60-day supply in Seattle might be a pound. And in Yakima, it might be an ounce. Right? So there was this vagary about a 60-day supply. So then, eventually, there's a bill that came around that defined the 60-day supply as 24 ounces. And this was after recommendations of 35 ounces and 71 ounces, right? It got cut down to 24, right? Now, this new bill coming across defines a 60-day supply as 3 ounces, but your doctor can recommend more. So, whose fault is that? Whose fault is it that something was really vaguely written into an initiative in such a way that a legislature could redefine it willy-nilly at any time. I don't recall I-502 putting that in Initiative 692 back in 1998. I believe that was the medical marijuana people, Americans for Medical Rights, that wrote that up. 60-day supply, nice and vague. So don't blame I-502 for that. If you wanted a strict limit, my God, you should have put something in the initiative to start with, or come up with another initiative in the intervening 14 years to better regulate medical marijuana. These people went along surfing the loopholes as if legalization was never coming, as if nobody was ever going to call them on all of these loopholes. And they seem to think that if 502 wouldn't have passed, they'd have just kept chugging along in loophole land and nobody would have bothered them. Sorry. If they'd have lost 502, the political will from the U.S. attorneys to conduct more raids would have been stronger than ever.
Yeah, the pendulum would have swung a y'all like a wrecking ball.
Yeah. Now, let me give you a... I told you before the break what this new bill would establish in Washington State. Let me just summarize it for you. If the governor signs this, medical marijuana possession limits in Washington would be higher than all but four of the 20 medical marijuana states. All but four. And considering that your doctor could recommend even more, then it's potential that the limits in Washington State for a seriously ill patient will be greater than any other state but Oregon. Medical marijuana cultivation limits in Washington State will be higher than Vermont, equal to Alaska, Colorado, and Maine, one seedling less than Hawaii and Nevada, and infinitely more than Arizona, Connecticut, D.C., Delaware, Illinois, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, and New Jersey. And again, that's with the three mature, three immature. Your doctor can still recommend up to 15 plants, which would be the highest limit of any state but California. This bill would also allow medical marijuana collectives that serve four patients with 12 to 60 plants and up to 2 pounds of usable marijuana. I can't think of another medical marijuana state that allows for such collective gardening. There would be legal medical marijuana dispensaries that provide sales and excise tax exemptions. There would be legal medical marijuana concentrates, something that gets you a felony in most medical marijuana states. And protection from arrest through a registry that every medical marijuana state but California has. So, pardon me if I'm not shedding a tear over the gutting of Washington State's medical marijuana when you're going to end up with a program that's far better, still one of the top three programs in the country.
Yep.
So there you go. I've got all of this going on my Facebook, Facebook page, Radical Russ on Facebook, if you want to check that out. Now, speed limits in the chat room, and he's asking about what's going on with Oregon? Here in Oregon, there's a bill to grant cities and localities the right to have a temporary moratorium on medical marijuana dispensaries. Mm. Right now, when it started out in the House, they wanted to have the power to ban. When it got to the Senate, they said, no, you can just regulate.
Yeah.
So the compromise between the two is, all right, we'll let you ban, but only until May of 2015. Now, I'm not for this. This is stupid. If marijuana is a medicine, and we're going to call it medical marijuana, and in our Oregon Medical Marijuana Act, it opens with the line that marijuana shall be treated as other medicines, then it makes no sense for a locality to be able to ban a medicine. I mean, that's like banning a Walgreens, right? Sorry, you can't have your Walgreens here. You guys have cough syrup.
Well, you know, that's like saying, sorry, you can't prescribe Prozac in this area.
Right.
You know,
right. You can't set up your Walgreens here because you sell cough syrup and we know that some people abuse cough syrup to get high. Right. That's the same kind of logic. Right. So this moratorium thing, compromise, you know, it's kind of a Solomonic compromise here, you know, split the baby in half kind of thing. But this is Oregon's in a weird situation, right? Let's say that this thing gets signed by the governor. And if it does, and I think it probably will, get signed by the governor, you're going to have places in Oregon, Medford, Ashland, Washington County, Eastern Oregon, that are going to ban dispensaries. No medical marijuana dispensaries. And with those bans will go up until May of 2015. And then May of 2015, there can be dispensaries. Now, meanwhile, we're working on getting recreational legalization on the ballot in November. There's a good chance it'll get on the ballot. And the recreational legalization plans, there's two of them right now that are fighting for ballot access. Both deal with pot shops, the creation of a recreational market. Now, the New Approach Oregon one explicitly allows localities to ban pot shops, recreational pot shops. So if this passes, right, gets on the ballot, we pass legal, I should say when it passes, when we pass legalization in Oregon, there'll be a period of time, and I think it's till like June or July, I think, I'm not certain on this, that the state is given to be able to come up with regulations for the pot shops. We might end up in a situation where recreational marijuana is legal and they're writing regulations for pot shops that would open in June of 2015. And then May 2015, when the moratorium ends, you'd have places opening up, you know, dispensaries at the same time. So is this an attempt perhaps to like forestall dispensaries and then wait for them all to be pot shops? And then once they're all pot shops, localities have the power to ban them? Is that what's going on here? And it seems to me kind of weird, too, to be fighting for legalization that allows for a ban of pot shops, but complaining about a ban on dispensaries. Now, I know the logic behind it, right? They're patients. They need medicine. You can't ban their medicine. But flip it, you know, away from the demand side, whether you're a recreational consumer demanding a pot shop or you're a medical consumer demanding a dispensary, flip it around from the demand side to the supply side. Think about the supply side of this. A pot shop is a building at which adults come to buy marijuana that they will use. A dispensary is a building at which adults will come in to buy marijuana that they will then take home and use. From a supply side, right? From the supply side, there's no difference. What's the difference between a dispensary and a pot shop? It's a building full of pot, handing it out to adults. So how is a pot shop any more of a blight on a neighborhood than a dispensary is? You're going to have adults walking in to a place with weed and walking out with weed after they hand someone money. What's the difference? Are we really to accept that building with the green cross on it and all the weed inside isn't a blight because the people using the weed are sick? But then the pot shop with the green leaf on it, with the healthy people going into it, why, that's a danger. Why? This is the absurdity that comes from trying to separate people who smoke pot into who's healthy enough to put in a cage and who's sick enough to leave alone. This is this continuing bifurcation of the marijuana movement based on the reason why you use pot that leads to all these absurdities. Like the absurdity, I hear this a lot, you know, about the, you know, well, patients need higher limits. Patients need more. Patients need more marijuana. And I don't dispute that, right? I can get by an ounce a week. Patient might need an ounce a day. I understand that. But again, flip it away from the demand side and take a look at it from the supply side. The ounce of marijuana doesn't change when it's handed to the healthy person versus when it's handed to the sick person. What terrible thing is going to occur with a healthy person possessing 24 ounces of marijuana that wouldn't occur with a sick person possessing 24 ounces of marijuana? Now, supposedly, the fear is that the recreational consumer of 24 ounces is going to divert it to the black market. Because, you know, patients would never do that. Oh, no. That would never happen. Someone on a fixed income, SSI, Social Security, disability, getting $600-$700 a month, has someone that grows weed for them, is able to give them up to a pound and a half of that weed, why, they'd never take an ounce or two of that and sell it on the black market for $500.
No.
No, it would never happen. This is why I keep getting into this spot. And, you know, I'm writing a book, by the way. And I'll let you guys in on this because you're the Toker Talk Radio listeners. I haven't made this public yet. But I'm writing a book. I put 7,000 words into it on Sunday. And the thesis of the book is cannabis is amazing medicine, but medical marijuana is bullshit. And I want everyone to be clear what I mean. Cannabis is amazing medicine. There is no denying the use of cannabis to treat cancers and glaucoma and epilepsy and cachexia and yada, 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 yada. PTSD, completely agreed, amazing medicine. But the concept of medical marijuana, the concept of separating people's use of marijuana by why they're using it, the concept of protecting only the sickest and most disabled, of standing up only for the politically expedient marijuana users, is bullshit. And it's continuing to be exposed as bullshit as we continue to legalize marijuana. And we have to reconcile, well, a pot shop for healthy people versus a pot shop for sick people, they have to have different rules. Why giving pot to healthy people has to be more restricted than giving it to sick people. And that's just absurd. Patients need more. Of course patients need more. What if I want more? You know, when they say this thing about, you know, oh, well, I need marijuana for medicine, you just choose to get high. That sounds to me like the person who blames the cute girl in the miniskirt for getting raped, because if she didn't want to get raped, why she wouldn't have dressed so sexy? If you didn't want to get arrested, why you shouldn't have smoked pot?
If you weren't sick.
Not
buying.
We'll
be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers, because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
Adam Hand of Handmade Apparel produces quality custom designs for t-shirts, hats, and other apparel. Handmade Apparel is the official design shop for 420 Radio, The Russ Belville Show, Ganja John, and Cascadia Concentrates, among many clients who rely on Adam Hand for everything from short-run custom projects to full-run clothing lines. Adam's meticulous designs are individually crafted and screened in vibrant high-definition color. Visit handmadeapparel.biz to browse the selection of handmade gear or to get a personal quote for your own designs. Handmade Apparel, a proud supporter of 420radio.org.
Support the Russ Belville Show. Text the word Russ to 420-420 and connect with the National Cannabis Coalition. You can also send $10 to the Russ Belville Show right from your smartphone. That's Russ to 420-420. You're listening to Radical Russ on the Russ Belville Show.
Well, I'll say little red calling, darling, your words to fail. Little red coffee, you need a lover that's gonna lay.
420 Radio, fighting prohibition since 2012. Have you considered medical marijuana? Double-blind, peer-reviewed studies have found cannabinoid therapies to be successful in treating the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease, ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease, brain cancer, chronic pain, diabetes mellitus, dystonia, fibromyalgia, GI disorders, hepatitis C, HIV/AIDS, hypertension, incontinence, MRSA, multiple sclerosis, osteoporosis, pruritus, rheumatoid arthritis, sleep apnea, and Tourette's syndrome, as well as anecdotal evidence in suggesting relief from anxiety, depression, and post-traumatic stress, plus reduction in the need for narcotic painkillers. Side effects from medical marijuana can include euphoria, relaxation, anxiety, panic reaction, paranoia, tachycardia, dry eyes, dry mouth, concentration and reaction time impairments, appetite increase, and in some U.S. states, arrest and incarceration. But medical marijuana is non-toxic and cannot cause overdose. Medical marijuana, it's not for everyone, but ask your doctor if medical marijuana may be right for you.
We'll be right back.
everybody. That's Flak Tie Bombers with "There's Still Time to Board the 7 O'Clock Smoke Boat." Pretty long title. Welcome back. It's 40 after the hour here on Toker Talk Radio. And you know what I would like to see in a lot of this medical marijuana debate, especially with what's going on in Washington? Data. I would like to see some data, right? Because here's one of my problems that I have with the medical marijuana movement. And it's something I've, in my book, I'm calling the original sin of medical marijuana. The original sin being, you know, abandoning the people that weren't politically expedient, right? So one of these things that happens in these debates about medical marijuana is how much marijuana patients need. Patients need more. I hear this all the time. Patients need more, right? And I was trying to find, I had seen this one time and God help me, I can't find it now. It's on the Google somewhere and I will find it. And I'll bring it back to you on a later show. But it was a survey of medical marijuana patients and it was asking them how much marijuana do they use on a regular basis. And I've got the chart somewhere. I don't remember where I put it. I've got this data somewhere. But what it showed was that the number of people who use more than a gram a day was really low, was a really low percentage. And this has always bothered me because in the medical marijuana movement, we've had this tendency to do what I call mascotting. Mascotting is when you bring forth a, you know, very sympathetic public story, public face for a campaign, right? Mascotting in 96 was, you know, bringing forth the cancer patient or the AIDS patient, the really sick, paralyzed person, bring him in front of a TV camera and say, my God, how could you not support this patient? How could you let this person suffer? And from that point on, we used the 99th percentile most disabled person as the example of what every patient would need. And that's just not true. Now, again, I don't deny that there are patients out there for whom 1 ounce of marijuana a day is reasonable. Absolutely, sure. What I'm saying is it's not all of them. It's not even 1% of them. Okay? There are plenty of medical marijuana patients out there in Washington State for whom 3 ounces is going to be a fine limit. It's going to be more than enough weed for them. There's plenty of those patients. All they're trying to do in Washington State is to take all those people who've been playing wink, wink, nudge, nudge and move them into the recreational system that they should have been in the first place. To take the people who've been availing themselves of loopholes, and I'm not casting aspersions on them. I do it. I'm using a loophole to get my caregiver card. I'm not castigating them. I'm just saying, what did you expect? You all this cheating, it's going to come back to bite us sometimes. And part of my thesis and part of my theory here about medical marijuana and the people using it for recreational purposes is borne out by the data. Let me give you an example. Today, I took a look. I got a story that came across today that gave us the latest medical marijuana registry numbers for the state of Colorado. Okay. In Colorado right now, as of January 2014, there are 111,000 red card holders. Red card is what they call their medical marijuana card. Okay. 111,000 patients in Colorado. 111,000 people who are so sick and debilitated that they got to get a medical marijuana card. Now, this is quite remarkable because back in January of 2009, just 5 years ago, there were only 5,000 red card holders. That's right. In 5 years, Colorado went from 5,000 red card holders to 111,000 red card holders. Now, what changed? Well, in 2009, dispensaries started popping up, became legal in Colorado. And throughout 2009, the growth of the registry was greater than 10% in almost every month. In fact, the growth of the registry went, and I'll just read you the increases, 7.5%, 9%, 13%, 13%, 17%, 24%, 30%, 20%, 24%, 43%, 32%, 29%. Over the year 2009, there was a gross increase of 950% in the Colorado registry. In the next year, 2010, increased from 53,000 patients to 118,000 patients, a growth of 124%. By the time we get to the end of 2012, there are 108,000 patients, and now there's 111,000 patients. And why this is so significant? Like I said, in 2009, the registry grew 950%. In 2010, the registry grew 124%. Now, in 2012, there was a 28% drop, and there was something must have happened between September and October of 2011, because about 20,000 patients dropped off the rolls. It was about 40,000, 30,000 between August and October of 11. So I don't know what happened there. I'll do some more research. But even then, when it got down to 85,000 in January of 2012, it increased to 108,000 by the end of the year, an increase of 27%. And looking through every month from 2009 to November of 2012, so every month from 2009 all the way up to the election that legalized, there was a positive increase from month to month in the registry, again, except for a five-month decrease in 2011. And I don't know what changed in the law there that made that happen. But generally speaking, the registry in Colorado for medical marijuana patients has increased every month since 2009. Then, in November of 2012, legalization happens. And from that point on, here's the changes month by month in the medical marijuana registry. Negative 1.6%. 1.7% positive, 0.1%, 0.3%, negative 0.4, negative 1.1, negative 1.3, 0.9, 2.3, 0.3, 3.0, negative 0.6, negative 1.2, 0.2, and 0.0. That is to say, the largest one-month jump since legalization has happened was 3%. The state went from 108,000 medical marijuana patients January of last year to 111,000. So they increased 3,000 patients. A little less, it's actually about 2,500 over the span of a year. So, gosh, why isn't the medical marijuana registry going up so much after we legalized? Well, let's find out. We got a call coming in from 330 area code. You're on the air with Toker Talk Radio. What's on your mind?
Hey, Russ. This is Stu in Ohio.
Hi, Stu.
I called once a while ago. I'm watching your show right now, and I am completely with you on everything you're saying there. What I'm seeing from my point of view is everyone out there, okay, medical marijuana. You can go into the store and buy your seeds and take them home and grow them yourself, but you guys yourselves say every plant grows different. Every different set of plants or set of genes from a different species or whatever name it is, white widow, I don't know all that stuff. What I'm saying is, how long does the medical marijuana community think that America is going to... I mean, you got... I'm elderly myself. I can't smoke anymore. I got to work for a living, and I'm afraid to lose my job.
Mm-hmm.
But I look at everybody out here, and from what I see the whole time, it's been arguing from the illegal growers who finally got their own licenses to grow, still want to call it medical marijuana. Okay, if it's medical marijuana, I would want Jorge Cervantes to grow mine for me because I couldn't take it home and grow it myself and think that that was going to get as powerful, as good a medicine as it is. No, it's not 100 times any stronger or anything else. When I was young and growing up, I smoked it. I did. I smoked the Columbia Redbud, the Centennial from Florida. I forget what little town or city that was. But anyway, the Thai stick, it was actually tied onto a stick. Tell me, I know what you guys are going through. This is ridiculous. It's medical marijuana is just marijuana that's grown better for people. The grass smokes the same pretty much all the way through. You can't tell me you get high and you get an hour high off of a hit of grass.
Yeah.
No way.
That's the thing that I want to address too, is that sometimes from patients, we'll get this thing where they say, well, It doesn't make me high. Bullshit. It makes you as high as it makes me. If I smoke pot every day, whether I'm healthy or sick, I will have the same tolerance. This idea that patients don't get high and they're the only people who don't get high is a mistake. Anybody who smokes pot regularly doesn't get high.
I would love to sit down and smoke a joint with someone, but I can't.
Yeah.
Okay? I got a couple years yet before I can retire. But I look at these people and I say, wow, why don't you guys all get together and go, hey, if you need it medically and a doctor says he can't prescribe it, he can recommend it. If the doctor recommends it for you, then you get your card, then you get your discount. What's the big deal with this? Everybody should be on the same ticket out there spreading the word. I tell everybody I can, and God forbid you say marijuana in my office. But you know what? Everybody's talking about it now.
That's right.
I'm not kidding you. Everybody's talking about it now. And how long do you think America's going to say, okay, Joe Schmo is going to go take this home and grow his own medicine? Give me a break.
I know, man.
Give America a break. Get on the freaking same set of rules and work as one. Stop arguing about, once you get it legal, then you can tax it. Good grief. It's not hard, people. Figure it out. Thanks, Russ.
I'm with you, Stu. Thank you so much for calling in. Our studio audience loves you, man. All right, we're going to take a break and cool down the phone. That was a great call, man. I appreciate that. Yeah, that's part of my attitude, too, is like, we're kind of in the thick of it here in the Pacific Northwest. How this bickering must look to people in Ohio, Texas, Georgia, yeah. Tennessee.
Some people over here are focused.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
This is Radical Russ encouraging you to take a look at the Weed Blog every day. Johnny Green and the staff at the Weed Blog are on top of all the latest developments in the fight to end marijuana prohibition nationwide. You can even get the Weed Blog on your smartphone by installing the Weed Blog app for iPhone and Android. If it's about weed, it's on the Weed Blog, including my original writing. So don't delay. Read the Weed Blog today.
The Russ Belville Show, starring Russ Belville from Portland, Oregon, live Wednesdays at 3 p.m. Pacific on 420radio.org.
Ever wonder how often to change your bong water? The most effective method for baking pot brownies? The best destinations for a ganja getaway? How to hide herb in your car? Whether to grow your own? How precisely to legalize it? Or how something as wonderful as marijuana ever got to be illegal in the first place? Finally, you can find all these answers and much more in the official High Times Pot Smokers Handbook, featuring 420 things to do when you're stoned. Since 1974, High Times Magazine has covered marijuana in all its aspects and wonders, from cultivation to legalization to the herb's enduring and exalted place in popular culture. Packed with inside information, the official High Times Pot Smokers Handbook wove all of this collected wisdom together into a single indispensable ganja guide, including an entertaining look at marijuana's history. Profiles of herb-friendly travel destinations and festivals, favorite potluck recipes from the High Times staff, smoking skills, advocacy and activism, essential marijuana movies and songs, profiles of famous cannabis strains, comprehensive growing information, celebrity endorsements, and much more. This is truly, finally, the ultimate guide to green living.
All right, well, you know, you know. Giant steps up would we take, walking on the moon. Oh, I hope my legs don't break, walking on the moon. I said we could walk forever, walking on the moon. I said we could be together, walking on the moon.
Welcome back, everybody. Heading out the end of the show here, about 54 after the hour, and real quick announcement here. A symposium designed to educate patients with multiple sclerosis on the use of medical marijuana, Oregon law, and how patients can be safe. Legal participants in the state's medical marijuana program will happen Sunday, April 6th at the Roseland Theater from 2 to 5 p.m. The event is free for anyone 18 or older, but you have to make reservations by April 1st. You can email events@msoregon.org. And our own Brian the Red will be down there taking a look at that. So,
yep. If I can, I will be.
Let's go back to the phones. We got a caller from 330 area code. What's on your mind?
Hey, it's Stu again. Oh, let me turn this thing down.
Hey, Stu.
I'm sorry. I kind of got a little quick there. If you don't mind, just another second on the phone.
Go ahead.
I only got about half of that out that I really wanted to tell them guys.
You hey, go ahead. We only got about 3 minutes.
Okay. I love what you guys are doing. It's fantastic. Everything you guys have done, it's just America starting to hear about it and open up and see it. Okay, if you want medical marijuana to work, it's the extracts, it's the oils, it's those waxes, it's the edibles, it's the root beer, the ice cream, the coffee, everything you guys are making, everything you're doing is fantastic. I'm sorry, I'm getting a little delay on the talk. I see you saying something, but I'm not hearing it.
Nope, that's okay. Thanks for the compliments. We appreciate it.
It's just that if you want medical marijuana to work, what you do is you legalize the whole plant. My God, that's what... Hell, what six... what'd you say it was? 6330507.
Yeah, okay? That's a patent.
U.S. patent. My God, they're saying it doesn't work. Is there any way America can sue the government?
Unfortunately,
what
not.
The
it's
heck
been
is
tried.
Going on here?
We have tried. Normal and a few other groups have tried to sue the federal government over a number of those things. One of them being the patent, another one being Schedule One and all that. And basically, the problem is that the law comes down to deciding whether the DEA is following the DEA's own rules, and the DEA gets to decide that.
Well, it's amazing to me that the system can break down from within its own top up there, those 550 suits or 455 suits we've got sitting in the, at the round end tables, and nothing ever gets done. And then when something so important to all these people happens and people start dying and they realize they know it helps. And they're not letting anything happen. I don't understand it. It's just America is a whole different thing to me anymore. I see things in a whole different light. And it's like you say, bikinis on the beach in front of the damn thing. I got friends of mine who go to a convention because they're in the union. And they said that we're out in California for a union convention. And they walk down them streets and they've seen that. And they come back here and they say what they see, and then people, what the heck is that? How is medical marijuana? You want it to work? By God, put it to work the way the government wants it to work, the way you want it to work. It can work together with this. You just got to.
I agree with you, Stu. Thank you so much for your call, and thank you for listening to the show. Please call back again sometime, but we're out of time for today. Coming up next, Stony Sundays with Coral Reefer, the new episode from just yesterday. Then replays of our first 2 hours, and then at 8 o'clock, another edition of the new Viper Hour live here from Rolla J Studios. For Brian the Red, I'm Radical Russ. Thanks for joining us, and until next time, take care of each other, Tokers.
This is the Russ Belville Show. The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it, you